Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
And welcome to our service this morning, especially if you're a visitor. And do come and join us for tea and coffee in the Minor Hall, just through this door after the service. We welcome the Reverend Alistair Bill to our pulpit for the first time today and for leading us in worship. Thank you. And welcome Ray again for leading us in praise. You have a copy of the bulletin in front of you. Meat and Munch is on tomorrow, even though it's a bank holiday. And we will be finishing the following Sunday, following Monday, the 5th of June for the summer and return again in September. Community Fridge is on Friday. And the Children and Youth Day will be next Sunday. Please make an effort to attend. The children have been working, young people have been working very hard to prepare to lead us in worship next Sunday. Thank you.
Good morning. Thank you. It's good to be here with you. I should say that as a teenager, my parents had a house in Port Ballantrae, and on summer Sundays, I used to sit somewhere down in there, but that was more than 50 years ago. Truth to tell, I don't remember very much about it. Let me say a little bit about myself so that you know who's standing in front of you. Originally from Temple Patrick, I was ordained in Larne as an assistant. I was called to work in the home mission in County Wicklow, so I ministered in Bray, Greystones and Arklow for half a dozen years, and then in County Monaghan, first Monaghan and Drum, before coming in 94 to Saintfield Road Congregation in South Belfast, where I was for 24 years. And then in 2018, we retired to Coleraine, and where we're now living, and we're members of Ballywillan Congregation. So it's good to be with you and to be conducting worship today. Two verses of scripture to begin our worship. Psalm 27, verse 14. Wait for the Lord. Be strong and take heart, and wait for the Lord. Isaiah 30 and verse 18. Yet the Lord longs to be gracious to you. He rises to show you compassion, for the Lord is a God of justice. Blessed are all who wait for him. Let's join in worship together as we sing, Rejoice, the Lord is King.
King adore.
Now let's unite our hearts as we pray together. Let's all pray. We rejoice to worship you as our Creator, the one true God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, supreme and powerful over everything else that would claim our affection and attention. We worship you as Savior. You've made yourself known in person. You've come into focus in Jesus Christ. Through him, you have visited and redeemed your people. We praise you that you are willing to offer your own righteous life as a sacrifice for our sin and shortcoming. Lord God, at this time we worship you especially as Spirit, working still in the midst of your people, bringing order out of chaos, giving life to the lifeless. You brought inspiration to the prophets and apostles, and still you make known the things of God, teaching us what your word means, educating our consciences, guiding us, comforting us, even rebuking us. Gracious God, we confess that often we feel weak. Sometimes we succumb to temptation. We doubt your promises. We lack courage and moral strength. We lose sight of you and your goals for our lives. Merciful God, forgive us through the shed blood of Jesus. Make us truly sorry for our sin and generate within us your power to live, your strength to overcome trial and temptation, and your will that we might serve you. Holy Spirit, breathe within us those qualities of heart and mind which we need to truly serve you. Give us a gentleness when we would be quick to judge. Give us strength in the vital things of life. Give us tolerance in that which is not essential. And may the fruit that you grow be seen in us. Love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control. By your Spirit, work in us, and above all, make us more like Jesus. We pray in his name. Amen. Now, our scripture reading is found in the book of Acts, chapter 2, reading at the first verse. Acts 2 from verse 1. When the day of Pentecost came, they were all together in one place. And suddenly a sound like the blowing of a violent wind came from heaven and filled the whole house where they were sitting. They saw what seemed to be tongues of fire that separated and came to rest on each of them. All of them were filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak in other tongues as the Spirit enabled them. Now they were staying in Jerusalem, God-fearing Jews from every nation under heaven. And when they heard this sound, a crowd came together in bewilderment because each one heard them speaking in his own language. Utterly amazed, they asked, "Are not all these men who are speaking Galileans? Then how is it that each of us hears them in his own native language? Parthians, Medes and Elamites, residents of Mesopotamia, Judea and Cappadocia, Pontus and Asia, Phrygian, Pamphylia, Egypt and the parts of Libya near Cyrene, visitors from Rome, both Jews and converts to Judaism, Cretans and Arabs, we hear them declaring the wonders of God in our own tongues. Amazed and perplexed, they asked one another, "What does this mean?" Some, however, made fun of them and said, "They have had too much wine." Ending there at verse 13, Amen. Now, I wonder would the boys and girls like to come to the front, because I'm going to have a wee bit of a competition to see if you can beat me.
Sorry, choir, you're not going to be able to see this. Do you know what that is? Excellent. The rest of you know what hangman is? Okay, we'll explain. Pardon? What? Excellent. Come on all in. Can we make a space? Yeah. Okay, come on all in. Can you get space up in front? Excellent. Move up. That's it. Great to see you. Can you move on this way? Can we all shift this way? Excellent. Well done. Now, hangman. This is going to be a hangman. And what you guys have to do is you've got to give me a letter. And if the letter is a correct one, we will write it on here. If the letter is not correct, I will start to draw a bit of my hangman. And if I get my man drawn here before you get the word, I win. But if you get the word before I finish my hangman, you win. Now, there's only one problem. I forgot to bring the prize. Okay, so who's going to give me a letter? You've only 26 to choose from. Okay, which letter would you like to give me? A. A is not one, so here's a head. Okay, what letter would you like to give me?
I
have two eyes, a nose, and a mouth to go. Okay, right. What do you think?
J.
What?
J.
J?
D.
D. D. Oh, you're nearly there. Only one more letter. Only one more letter. Which one do you think it should be? I didn't hear that one. Which is today, Pentecost. Sometimes people call it the birthday of the church. The day when the Holy Spirit came. Something really special. And I've just been reading about it from the Bible. And you know what? Everybody behind you and up on the gallery have been itching to call out a letter. But now they're going to get a chance to be involved. Because there was all these things happened on Pentecost. And here's what's going to happen now. Okay. There was a sound like a big wind. So I'm going to ask the people who are sitting in the center block to produce some wind. Okay? That sort of way. Okay? So let's have. Don't you be laughing? Don't you be laughing? So practice your blow. And you can do it any bit of the help. Blow. Very good. We're going to need to practice again. Okay. Now. There was also Give me oil in my lamp. Keep me burning. That's a prayer. Give me oil in my lamp, my friend. Thank you.
Now let's unite our hearts in prayer again. Lord God, on this Pentecost day, we give thanks for your church, the church that you have created upon the foundation of Jesus Christ, which you have sustained and caused to grow, and which is growing especially in what we're accustomed to call the third world. Thank you for your church throughout the world, in all its different branches, in all its different cultures, races, and nations. Thank you that you have produced a witness for yourself and that you sustain it by your grace. We pray for your church. Where it's strong, keep it true to you. Where it's weak, strengthen. Where it's persecuted, sustain. Where it's comfortable, remind it of its first love. And where it's lacking, may it know the help of others. And today we pray for two parts of your church with which we are in partnership here in the Presbyterian Church in Ireland. We pray for the Presbyterian Church in Myanmar, formerly Burma. We pray for families who have lost loved ones, been injured, had their property destroyed, and been driven from their homes due to airstrikes earlier this month. We pray for just government in that land that values all its citizens and doesn't persecute them. We pray for our mission partners, Stephen and Angelina Cowan in Kenya. We give thanks for rainfall in Tum and across northern Kenya over recent weeks. We pray that there will be a good harvest, and also that the seed of God's word sown at the recent senior camp will bring forth much fruit. And closer to home, we would pray for young people known to us taking examinations. Give them patience and good study habits, that they can do their best and know your peace as they do so. Father, we pray for this congregation, for its elders and leaders, for its vacancy convener, for wisdom and discernment that all might lead well, that the congregation might prosper even during the vacancy. We remember those who are sick, and those who mourn, those who are anxious and uncertain, who are lonely. We ask, Heavenly Father, that we might be a good fellowship, supporting and encouraging each other through times of difficulty. We pray that you, by your Spirit, will be a sustaining grace to each and every one. Hear our prayer, which we bring in the name of Jesus. Amen. We worship God with our offering. Let us pray. Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, you pour out your gifts on us day after day, physical, mental, emotional, spiritual. Thank you for all the gifts you give for the building up of your church, teaching, pastoring, helping, musical, technical, discernment, administration, evangelism. Without your work, we could not be, your people. Thank you for all of them. As we give you our offerings, we commit ourselves to serve you as you have gifted us individually and together to the glory and praise of your name. Amen. We join to sing again, Speak, O Lord. We have two grandchildren who live just outside Lisburn. And each Tuesday in term time, either my wife Angela or myself picks them up from school. But a week ago, we heard we wouldn't be required for last Tuesday. And as I had no meetings in Belfast, that opened up an opportunity for my wife to travel to London to see our latest granddaughter, who's just 8 weeks. Could arrangements be made for her to travel last Monday? Could they what? And they were. Now, if you're a grandparent, especially a grandmother, dying to see your grandchild, You'll know how long those 48 hours were until my wife was safely deposited at the airport. Waiting. As a child, it's one of the hardest things we have to learn. Waiting. Waiting for Christmas, for birthdays, for holidays, waiting for special treats. And even as adults, we're not particularly good at waiting. Deferred satisfaction isn't part of our makeup. And so the advertisers play on that. You need this product to make your life complete, and you need it now. There's a Belfast humour. New apprentices, either in the shipyard or in large factories, would be sent to another department to fetch a long stand. And when they got there, would be told, just wait over there. And it would take them a while to realise they had been had. Just before his ascension, Jesus gave the disciples this command, do not leave Jerusalem, but wait for the gift my Father promised, which you heard me speak about. For John baptized with water, but in a few days you will be baptized with the Holy Spirit. And so after the Lord had ascended, the disciples returned to Jerusalem, waiting for the fulfillment of his promise. They really did believe that Christ was going to send the Holy Spirit. They had no doubt, there was no wavering. They were confident the promise would be fulfilled and the Holy Spirit would come. But what did they know about the coming of the Spirit? They didn't know when it would happen. They didn't know what form his coming would take. But they did know what their Lord had said, that the Spirit's coming would enable them to be his witnesses in Jerusalem, in Judea and Samaria, and to the ends of the earth. But there's something else. During that time of waiting between the ascension and Pentecost, they became increasingly aware of their need to have the Spirit. During Christ's life, they had known his exhilarating presence. And even during the 40 days between resurrection and ascension, they'd been repeatedly blessed by his visits. But during those 10 days, the disciples undoubtedly felt empty. More than ever, they were aware how important was the presence of their Savior. And now, he was gone. They felt empty. They needed him. Those words from John 15, apart from me, you can do nothing, came back to them again and again. And that sense of need was actually making them ready for what would happen. And so it was that on that day of Pentecost, they were together. It's likely they were in prayer together, just as they'd been on those other days. And we know what happened, and we have rehearsed it. Three signs, three supernatural signs. A sound like the blowing of a violent wind, what seemed to be tongues of fire. The disciples speaking in other tongues so that all those visiting from round the eastern Mediterranean understood what was being said. But what did it mean? Signs. Signs point to something. And if they're supernatural signs, then they're God's way of showing what he was doing. So first of all, we have a sound like the blowing of a violent wind. It's analogical, trying to find a parallel to what happened, trying to speak of a mystery that can only be touched on. It's not a light sea breeze, but it's something that's uncontrollable. Taking other scripture references, for example, Ezekiel 37, which is about the valley of dry bones, wind speaks of God breathing life into a defeated, dead, and exiled people. Or taking the words of Jesus in John 3, wind is God bringing new life. And for us, there's a sense that power for renewal comes only from God. And then there's what seem to be tongues of fire. Again, it's analogical. Trying to explain the unexplainable. And so we recall how John the Baptist was associated with fire, purifying, cleansing. And we remember that God's Spirit is the Holy Spirit, pure beyond our experience, purifying for the glory of God, cleansing from sin. And so God's holiness has come to rest on people, even on ordinary human people. And then there's other tongues or languages. Now, there's lots of discussion, even controversy around this. So how does it relate to speaking in tongues in 1 Corinthians 12 to 14? It's not certain how it does. But what is sure is that all the visitors from Persia, Iran, Asia Minor, Egypt, Libya, Rome, Crete, Arabia, all of them heard the good news of Jesus. They heard, quote, the wonders of God in their own tongues. There's a comment in my Encounter with God notes this morning. Everyone was able to say, God speaks my language. And that brings it right up to date. God speaks my language. And what does it mean today? God, the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit is active in creative power. God is present. He is a purifying presence. God has a message for everyone. There are no boundaries of nation, of race, or of culture. The message is for all the known world. The gospel of God's wonders are for everyone. God's presence and God's power is for all. That's different to the Old Testament, the Old Covenant. There we read about the Spirit of God coming upon leaders, Moses, Samson, Gideon, or upon kings, Saul or David, or prophets, Elijah. But the Spirit only came for particular tasks at a particular time. But after Pentecost, God by His Spirit comes on all His people. And God is not away out there. God is not away from us. God is not only with His people, He's in His people. And later on, if you read the rest of Acts 2, when Peter addresses the crowd, he quotes from Joel chapter 2. God's promise that His Spirit will come on all people, women as well as men, younger as well as older. And of course, Jesus in the upper room, John 16, told the disciples, the Spirit of truth, the Counselor, the Advocate would come, that He would guide the disciples into all truth. And that He would convict the world regarding sin and righteousness and judgment. Jesus could not stay in space and time. So He left in order that He could be eternally present, that He could be everywhere present. The Spirit is Jesus, living in and through His people, giving us a sense of holiness, a desire to live out our faith, to proclaim God's Good news. God's Spirit, God's breath of life, comes to make his home in every believer. God, by his Spirit, is in us every day. But of course, we need to submit to him, to let him guide and teach us, to convince us that his way is best. Pentecost was also called the Feast of Weeks. 7 weeks it was. It was the day when Jewish people celebrated the early wheat harvest. It was a pilgrim festival when all adult Jewish men would come from every point of the compass to Jerusalem to be part of that celebration. And that's why so many different peoples were there. And people thought of it as celebrating first fruits. But not only would it henceforth be the celebration of the wheat harvest, God turned it into a spiritual harvest. 3,000 were added to the disciples that day after Peter spoke. And it became the first fruits of those who were brought into the kingdom of God. And it all started with waiting. People waiting in need. And every revival of faith has started with waiting upon God. People waiting, knowing that they needed him, needed more of God in their lives. That's what happened in 1859, the year of grace in Kells, County Antrim. 10 days ago, I was talking to a pastor online, and he told me about the Lowestoft revival that I'd never heard about. And so I looked it up. It was 1921. It mainly involved Scottish fishermen and fisher lassies who would come down each autumn for the herring fishing. And these open-air meetings would be held. And many came to faith. And at the same time, the Spirit of God moved strongly here in Ulster through the work of W.P. Nicholson. And even though there was a lot of political tension and bloodshed, especially in Belfast, many thousands came to faith through the missions that Nicholson held. And someone has written, many churches gained additions, some 100, some double, prayer meetings, Bible classes, missionary meetings, all increased in strength. Ministerial candidates doubled. And if you're a subscriber to the Presbyterian Herald and you haven't yet read it, read about the awakening that happened at the university campus of Ashbury in Kentucky back in February. It's all about young students waiting on God. And we have David Legg from Portadown who was there, and this is his photograph that is in the Herald and which I'm using today. So let me ask a question. As a congregation, what are you waiting for? You're waiting for a new minister. Yes, but is that all? During a vacancy, there's almost a temptation to put congregational life on hold. But one thing you need to do, and our congregation is about to go into a vacancy, and we could fall into that temptation just as well. But one thing we need to do is to wait on God. As those disciples did back on that first Pentecost day. Wait on God in prayer and in expectation, because that is the most important thing. For the disciples, waiting brought about a renewed purpose, meant receiving power to be his witnesses. And of course, waiting time can be a significant period in preparing us to continue our spiritual journey. And so the question I leave with you Do we really feel the need of the Lord in our lives and in the life of our congregation? Shall we pray? Lord God, thank you that our times are in your hands. Give us the grace to wait on you, to see your purposes in our waiting. Fill us with expectation that you will work in us and that you will equip us with your power to be your witnesses here in our locality, in this wider area, and further afield. Minister by your Spirit to the praise and glory of your name. Amen. Our closing hymn, O Breath of Life. And now may God the Father enrich you with his grace, God the Son make you holy in his love, and may God the Holy Spirit strengthen you with his joy, and the blessing of God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit be with us this day and forevermore. Amen.